Good evening, everyone, and welcome back to Answers on Eschatology. My name is Dan Derry, and I'm the president of the Institute of Fulfilled Eschatology. Hey, I want to share some more thoughts with you this evening on Matthew 24 and verse 30, and the phrase, "Then they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory." Now, up to this point, in the last several videos, we've showed you that Jesus, using this metaphor of his coming on the clouds, in fulfillment of Daniel 7, 13 to 14, was referring to his coming in judgment upon Old Covenant Israel in AD 70. And that is easily understood. Clouds, or the Lord's coming in clouds, or a cloudy day, a dark and cloudy time, or the day of the Lord with clouds, is common Old Testament metaphorical prophetic language that depicts judgment of Jehovah, either upon Israel or upon a foreign nation, at the hands of another nation. Now, in my days in partial preterism, I understood Matthew 24 to refer to the Lord's coming in judgment based upon the metaphor of coming in clouds and how that's used in the Old Testament. And by the way, Isaiah 19 verse 1 is a great example. We have the Lord coming to Egypt riding on a swift cloud as a metaphor for his judgment. Well, we know that the Lord didn't bodily come into Egypt. Egypt was judged by Babylon and King Nebuchadnezzar, but it was at the Lord's coming on clouds. So based upon Old Testament prophecy and the metaphor of clouds surrounding judgment, I understood that Matthew 24, 30 referred to that, and referred to the judgment of Old Covenant Jerusalem in AD 70. But here's what I missed for years. And if you're a partial preterist, here's what I want you to understand, is that there is no two comings, two parousias in the New Testament. One for a coming in judgment in AD 70 at the old covenant, at the end of the Old Covenant age, and a coming of the Lord for salvation or redemption at the end of the Christian age or at the end of time. And that's the way I understood the coming of the Lord for years. I didn't understand that his coming in judgment was his coming with salvation. His coming in judgment was a double-edged sword. It would be to separate the wheat from the tares, the sheep from the goats, the wheat from the chaff. All these metaphors that are used throughout the New Testament, this is the coming of the Lord. This takes place at the coming of the Lord, where the righteous are saved and vindicated, and the wicked are judged and condemned and cast out. And I want to show you that from Old Testament prophecy. We have no biblical precedent based upon Old Testament prophecy to say, well, AD 70 was the coming of the Lord in vengeance upon Old Covenant Israel, but at the end of time, at the end of the Christian age, the Lord's going to come with salvation and come to complete the atonement, to complete the redemption. That's not how the Old Testament prophets prophesied the coming of the Lord. I want to show you that in this video, which will set us up for the next several videos as well. Go with me to Isaiah chapter 35. Watch this. For time's sake, let's just read verses 2 down to 4. It will blossom profusely and rejoice with rejoicing and shout of joy. The glory of Lebanon will be given to it, the majesty of Carmel and Sharon. They will see the glory of the Lord, the majesty of our God. Encourage the exhausted, and strengthen the feeble. Say to those with anxious heart, take courage, fear not. Behold, your God will come with vengeance. The recompense of God will come, but he will save you. So here we have the coming of the Lord in both vengeance and with salvation. Both elements, vengeance, judgment, and salvation at one singular coming of the Lord. And this is Israel's salvation, Israel's vengeance at the end of Israel's Old Covenant age. Go with me to Isaiah 59. We're going to see the same thing. Isaiah 59, let's just read verses 17 down to 20. He put on righteousness like a breastplate and a helmet of salvation on his head, and he put on garments of vengeance for clothing and wrapped himself with zeal as a mantle. According to their deeds, that's Israel, he will repay wrath to his adversaries, recompense to his enemies, to the coastlands he will make recompense. So they will fear the name of the Lord from the west and his glory from the rising of the sun. For he will come like a rushing stream, which the wind of the Lord drives. A redeemer will come to Zion, and to those who turn from transgressions in Jacob, declares the Lord. Once again, we have the coming of the Lord in both vengeance and in wrath upon Israel, yet at that time, he would come in redemption. He would come to Zion as redeemer to those who turn from transgression in Jacob. In other words, he would come in vengeance upon those who did not turn from transgression, but he would come with salvation for those of Israel, i.e. the righteous remnant, who did turn from transgression in Jacob, in Israel. See, the coming of the Lord is a singular coming. It's his coming in wrath and in salvation. Now, go with me to Luke chapter 21. I want to show you from Luke 21, which is obviously a parallel discourse to Matthew 24, that the coming of the Son of Man on the clouds of heaven in Matthew 24 and Luke 21 is, yes, the coming of the Lord in judgment, in the cloud, as judgment upon Old Covenant Israel in AD 70. But it is also the Lord's coming in salvation to consummate the atonement and to establish the new covenant. We have every element from Isaiah 35 and Isaiah 59 in Luke 21. We have the coming of the Son, the coming of the Lord as the coming of the Son of Man. We have that coming in vengeance, and we have that coming in redemption. And Jesus places that all at the fall of Jerusalem, at the end of the Old Covenant age. Watch this. Luke 21, and let's start in verse 20. Here's the context. But when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then recognize that her desolation is near. Verse 22, because these are the days of vengeance, so that all things which are written will be fulfilled. So the days of vengeance were in the first century when Jerusalem was surrounded by armies. Watch this. Verse 27. When Jerusalem was surrounded by armies in the days of vengeance, then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. See, that's the coming of the Son of Man in vengeance upon Old Covenant Jerusalem. But watch the next verse. This isn't just his coming in judgment. This is his coming in salvation. But when you see these things begin to take place, straighten up and lift up your heads, because your redemption draws near. That is the coming of the Redeemer to Zion with redemption to those who turn from transgressions in Jacob. This is the fulfillment of Isaiah 35 and Isaiah 59. It is the coming of the Lord as the coming of the Son of Man. He is coming in the glory of the Father to repay Israel according to their works. He would bring vengeance for those who would not turn to him and receive his kingdom, but he would come with salvation and with redemption as Redeemer to those who received the gospel of the kingdom. And listen what Jesus says in verse 32. Verily, verily, I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all these things be fulfilled. Jesus placed the singular coming of the Lord in fulfillment of Isaiah 35, Isaiah 59, the hope of Israel. He placed that coming, which was the Lord's coming in vengeance, in judgment upon it of Old Covenant Jerusalem in AD 70, but that coming in the clouds of heaven was the Lord's coming with redemption and his coming to bring Israel salvation and to consummate the establishment of the kingdom of God and the new covenant promised to his covenant people Israel. And listen, what that means is that this coming on the clouds of heaven is not just a metaphor for judgment, it is. But it's a metaphor for his coming with salvation, for his coming with redemption. And next time on Answers on Eschatology, we're going to dig into this coming of the Lord with the cloud, with the glory cloud, and how that applies to the body of Christ, the new covenant temple. And we're going to show you that this coming of the Lord, this coming of the Son of Man, the clouds of heaven, was not only in judgment, it was in salvation. It was to glorify the body of Christ and the new covenant temple. And we'll get to that next time on Answers on Eschatology. Bye for now.